What if the deadliest plague in history wasn't confined to the past, but ready to strike again? The Black Death wiped out up to 50 million people, nearly half of Europe's population at the time. But what if it returned today? With our globalized world, packed cities, and fast travel, how fast would it spread? Could modern medicine stop it in time? Or would panic and collapse take over first? We're diving deep into the nightmare scenario on this episode of the Infographics Show. What if the Black Death plague happened today? The Black Death started in 1346 and it was brought in via the most common of pests, fleas. These tiny insects were carrying with them a strain of the bacteria Yersinia pestis, now known as the bubonic plague. It was a nasty disease that carried a whole host of symptoms, including fever, headaches, and vomiting, along with painful swollen lymph nodes, skin discoloration, and nasty pustules on the skin. It was painful and uncomfortable, and if left untreated, could easily kill the person. And it went through Europe like wildfire. An airborne disease, it crossed continents over a 7-year period, and the rudimentary medical science at the time was completely unable to deal with it. It's believed to have killed close to 50% of the European population and kicked off what's known as the Second Plague Pandemic, a wave of diseases that ripped through the weakened population. It changed the culture of Europe forever, and it gave us some unforgettable visuals, like the black-clad, masked plague doctors who were hired to minister to the ill. However, they could often do little but comfort the dying and record the death toll. But hey, at least it's gone, right? Only one disease has ever been eradicated, the virus smallpox. All the others essentially become endemic, but most become semi-neutralized due to mutations weakening the virus and advances in medical science making it much easier to treat. This is exactly what happened to the bubonic plague, which still exists in the wild and infects hundreds of people each year. Between 2010 and 2015, there were over 3,200 according to the WHO. But both vaccines and treatments exist for the plague now, with several antibiotics like streptomycin, gentamicin, and doxycycline being effective for treating it. If people seek treatment, they are likely to survive. But many people don't know how much danger they're in. The bubonic plague made it back into the news in recent days when a northern Arizona resident died under mysterious circumstances. The diagnosis was pneumonic plague, which is caused by the same virus but primarily affects the lungs. It's believed that he didn't seek treatment until it was too late, and he likely contracted it from an animal that had been colonized by infected fleas. Doctors saw the alarm this caused when the news broke and assured people that there was little risk if they sought treatment. After all, there were plenty of treatments. At least, there are for now. In 1997, scientists in Madagascar had made an alarming discovery. They found a strain of Yersinia pestis, the bacterium that causes the plague, that was resistant to the antibiotics that had neutralized it. They tested all the normal antibiotics on it as well as a cocktail, and they found that it survived. However, after a range of tests, they found another antibiotic, trimethoprim, that killed it, as it was supposed to, and the disaster was averted. The disease didn't spread, but it was a sober warning. We have evolved to fight the disease, but it can evolve to fight us too. And we might not know until it's too late. The plague evolves, but it does so silently, as it reproduces amid fleas on pest animals, and it would take a while before anyone notices. But when it does, we would start seeing more cases of plague in humans, and not everyone would pay attention. The first alert would likely come from a science website warning of a coming disaster. But as we all know, it's hard to get attention for a serious science article when there is celebrity gossip to pay attention to. And so it's likely that people would see the warning articles and ignore them. And many people might not even believe it was happening. In 2020, the deadliest pandemic of the 21st century, COVID-19, struck, a lethal virus that affected the respiratory and immune systems until it was largely neutralized by a series of vaccines. It disrupted life as we know it for over a year, and if you ask a lot of people, it took their faith in the government with it. Some people thought that the government didn't take it seriously enough, while others thought that they used it as an excuse to oppress people, and many doubted it was a threat at all. After all, the vast majority survived COVID-19 with symptoms not worse than the flu, and if it didn't affect them, the doubters didn't take it seriously. So, when the government starts making alarmed statements about the return of the plague, it's likely that people would just dismiss it as scaremongering, at least until it became impossible to avoid. We have one big advantage that the peasants of the 14th century didn't. We know a lot more about each other. It's likely that most people would become aware of just how serious this disease was, not through the news or government warnings, but through social media. After all, it is a disease like any other, right? At least until your favorite influencer posts sick as a dog and shows off the blackening skin and swollen lymph nodes that are very much not making her look more fashionable. That might make people step up and take notice. And then, of course, they would panic. If there's one thing we know about pandemics in the current era, it's that people might be more dangerous than the disease. As soon as word spreads that the plague is back and it's showing resistance to antibiotics, people would likely react with terror and try to take care of their own. We would see a quick return to the panic buying that characterized the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic. People would crowd grocery stores trying to get their hands on essential supplies and battling over the last roll of toilet paper. And ironically, by crowding into those aisles and wrestling each other over a can of beans, the plague would spread, and spread fast. And that would mean that it's time for the government to step in. In the United States, most people still talk about the lockdowns they experienced, or didn't. While most states did close businesses and even public access facilities for a time to minimize public exposure, there were relatively free restrictions on the movement of individual people. Nothing was stopping you from getting into your car and exploring, but you would be limited in where you could actually get in. And that seems foreign to much of the rest of the world, where even leaving your home unauthorized could have got you nabbed by the cops. But this time things would be very different. COVID-19 was a deadly virus due to how fast it spread, but much more like the common cold it's related to, it mutates fast and becomes less virulent as it becomes better at spreading. The vast majority of those infected with COVID-19 survived with no ill effects, and a vaccine was developed in under a year, so restrictions were quickly lessened. However, the bubonic plague is one of the most virulent diseases ever discovered by science, being both incredibly deadly and incredibly fast at spreading via both airborne and skin-to-skin contact. And that means the government would need to act fast. By the time the public knows this new stream of plague is in the wild, odds are it would be almost everywhere. We live in a global economy, and materials containing the infected fleas would have been shipped around the world and started spreading like wildfire. There would probably be thousands of cases by the time the government made a statement, and there would be plenty more that we don't even know about yet. So, to try to stem the spread, the government would likely order emergency actions including full lockdowns. And surely the public would react in a calm and reasoned manner, right? Well, it's likely that the announcement of another pandemic lockdown would spur furious reactions, including riots. A new pandemic would cause intense paranoia and conspiracy theories, and the fact that it's a disease associated with history would only make certain people more skeptical. The government would do their best to shut down the protests, but they can only do so much when a large portion of the public is rallied against them. Public order would be one of the biggest changes of this new Black Death outbreak, at least until the bodies start piling up. The panic shoppers and the protesters would be among the first to be at a high risk of contracting the disease after the people initially exposed. But while COVID was largely an invisible disease, with people not showing any exterior symptoms, the Black Death can be horrific. As cases ramp up and people start seeing pictures of people with burst open sores, gasping for air as they breathe their last, even the most skeptical will start to get scared. But by then, it'll likely be too late. The first line of defense wouldn't be soldiers, it'll be scientists. The moment news breaks that a potentially antibiotic-resistant strain of the Black Death is loose, labs around the world would go on red alert. All the best minds would be deputized to investigate the disease and break it down into components to try to figure out exactly what strain of antibiotics would work on it. And as all the usual suspects come up empty, it becomes clear that this is something new, and they would work on sequencing the strain's DNA and experimenting with new types of antibiotics to neutralize it. But this is like finding a needle in a haystack, if they can stay alive that long. And so safety would become the word of the day. Part of what makes the plague such a tricky disease is the fact that it spreads through multiple means and manifests in different ways. Bubonic plague and its variant septicemic plague are spread through bites from infected fleas, with septicemic plague infecting the blood and being invariably fatal. Pneumonic plague, meanwhile, can be spread through breathing in airborne droplets, and it's nearly always fatal. Because of the different entry points, the protection from this disease would take more than one form. Protective clothes, especially for medical professionals working with the victims, would be essential. And then, of course, there are the masks. It's one of the most iconic parts of the Black Death. The plague doctors. These medieval medical professionals often didn't bring much to the table in terms of medical knowledge. Many of them believed in primitive concepts like humors and bloodletting, and often they couldn't do much for their patients. They did, however, provide an invaluable service in terms of keeping records of the disease that are coming in very handy now as we look back on those logs to see what to do and what not to do. And of course, They were also completely terrifying. They wore sleek black robes that made them look like little reapers. But by far, the most distinctive part of their costumes was their bird-like mask, complete with a sharp, pointed beak and the black hat on top. Now, this might seem like nothing but aesthetic. After all, who wants to look at this when they're dying of the plague? But it actually did serve a purpose. The mask actually served as a rudimentary respirator, with a nose containing aromatic items like roses and herbs, which were designed to block out the smell of death. Back then, this smell was known as miasma, and it was believed to cause the disease itself, with the herbs fending off the evil smells. Needless to say, that is not accurate, but no one wants to smell corpses. So, are we likely to see this terrifying visage walking the streets once again? While many of the theories about the initial mask and how to protect from the disease turned out to be false, it's believed that the mask and the costume did provide some protection. The robe was waxed to fend off fleas, and the mask and robe guarded against the blood and cough splatters that dying patients might produce. But today, we know far more about protective gear. So while doctors and security officers will likely be wearing modern gear, it's entirely possible a plague doctor outfit will make a return in another way, as a fashion item. As the disease spreads, people who are lucky enough to avoid it will be cooped up inside for the most part, and they're no doubt going to be looking for ways to keep busy. Homemade plague doctor outfits will no doubt be a hot item, and the odds are people will be trying to compete with each other for the best outfit. Even as the world potentially ends, social media will still be king. If there is one thing we learned from the previous pandemics and disasters, there's no limit to the level of gallows humor people will have, and they might not be able to resist showing them off. The government will be aggressively trying to discourage people from going out and spreading the disease, but there is only so much they can do. After all, there are only so many officers on the streets, and the odds are this public-facing position will be one that has a higher-than-average rate of contracting the plague. That'll lead to shortages on the force, and that would mean that lawbreakers might have an easier time skirting quarantines and lockdowns and getting out on the town. And what they're doing out there might be party time. One of the most iconic and terrifying tales of Edgar Allan Poe was The Mask of the Red Death. It was the tale of an arrogant prince who hosts a massive party during a fictional plague, boasting that his castle is safe from the disease, only to be proven very wrong. And naturally, many people read that story and they went, "Well, that party sounds awesome." Social events would likely go underground, but there will always be many people who will ignore government warnings and take their lives in their own hands. But they might not want to be seen. Ironically, the most convenient use for plague doctor masks during this era might be the opposite of their intention. They could easily become a sign of rebellion, as those who skirt the quarantine decide to don them and keep their identity a secret. While this won't be safe by any stretch, the disguises will serve a dual purpose, covering their identity and protecting them somewhat from the deadly disease. But sooner or later, this crisis will become all too real. While most fast-spreading diseases are dangerous, few are near universally lethal. A fatality from the flu is exceedingly rare, while even deaths from COVID or measles are far from the majority. But plague is different. Two versions, if left untreated, are almost invariably fatal. Bubonic plague is actually the least deadly version, but it has a rate of at least 30% fatality if untreated, and some studies say as much as 60%. Even for those who survive, it can lead to permanent disfigurement and disability, which means this plague is going to do more than leave its mark. It will devastate the world. A true antibiotic-resistant plague outbreak is going to cut through civilization like a hot knife through butter. You're likely to see deaths reach into the millions around the world within months, with many countries seeing levels of dying that are near impossible to accurately catalog. And that'll result in another pressing issue: where to put all of those bodies? Unlike the other diseases like COVID, plague is actively still contagious when the victim dies, thanks to bacteria lingering in the bodily fluids and sores. And that means some old-fashioned solutions might be needed. There isn't a lot of space to put excess bodies, as anyone who tried to find a plot to lay grandma to rest finds out. Several million excess deaths aren't going to go into the ground easily. That means for the countless deaths from this new plague, officials might need to consider options like mass graves, burial at sea, which could cause extensive water pollution, or cremation, which would cause significant air pollution. After all, the world population during the original Black Death was around 400 million people, and today it's closer to 20 times that. A world-decimating plague would cause a level of death never seen before in human history. But is it likely to be as bad as last time? The disease is just as bad as it was the last time, and without antibiotics, there is no cure. Everyone who gets two of the three variants is going to die, along with many who get bubonic plague. But that doesn't mean that we're without weapons. We understand disease much better than we ever did during the first plague. For one thing, we understand sanitation. During the outbreak of the 1300s, there was one area of Europe that didn't see the same level of death – Poland. It only suffered a death rate of 8% compared to some areas which lost a majority of their population. That wasn't just luck, it was a perfect storm of unexpected defenses. For one, the king enforced strict border closures, keeping potential carriers out. There was also a large Jewish population, many of whom practiced ritual hand washing, an act of faith that unknowingly became a life-saving health measure. On top of that, less available food in the region meant fewer rats, and fewer rats meant fewer fleas to spread the plague. So long as we get everyone to do their part, we should be just fine, right? Well, one of the biggest challenges for combating a new Black Death will be getting cooperation. During the 1300s, a town or city's response was usually guided by its leadership, which was often the local clergy. This could lead to chaos or to stunning sacrifice. The town of Eme in England reportedly quarantined itself on the advice of its minister. The plague burned through the village and led to the majority of the village dying, but it stopped it from spreading to merchant visitors. That level of sacrifice is likely beyond many people today, but as the seriousness of the disease becomes clear, stay inside, wear protective gear, and wash your hands might be doable. After all, those bubonic plague selfies are pretty horrific. And we have another secret weapon, the scientists. During the original Black Death, the idea of vaccinations or antibiotics simply didn't exist. The simplest disease or infection from a cut could kill a person, and little could be done. Over the last 100 years, science has advanced to the point that would seem like fantasy to a medieval peasant. And now, with this new variant, it's all been stripped away. Or has it? The basic foundations of medical science still work, even if this new variant has eluded it. There's no such thing as a variant that is truly vaccine-proof or antibiotic-proof. It's just a question of finding the right puzzle piece, and the entire world will be searching for it. Even amid a global plague pandemic that is killing millions, world leaders will be staying in contact and coordinating their efforts. While some countries might be skeptical, either not trusting vaccine science or wanting to see a rival nation suffer, the consequences of the plague are just too high for pettiness to win the day in most cases. The isolation and shutdowns forced by the Black Death would devastate world economies as industry after industry collapses, and there is no greater motivation out there than money. And sooner or later, a breakthrough would happen. While it's not clear what would happen first, a vaccine or a new strain of antibiotics, the odds are that one would closely follow the other. The key would be finding out what separates this strain from the other ones in the wild and how to counteract that. The best microbiologists in the world would be working nonstop from the secure labs in their home countries, and the medical tech companies would likely be under a lot of pressure to mass produce it and make it as available as possible. And now they just have to get people to take it. A new Black Death today would be incredibly devastating, grinding the global economy to a halt and likely resulting in tens of millions of deaths. And it would have one big difference from the previous outbreak. To a large extent, the death toll would be relatively self-selecting. The majority of people would have awareness of what's causing the disease and how to avoid it. And those who don't catch it in the first wave are able to successfully isolate and use caution and sanitation and would have a good chance of surviving the disease long enough until a cure is provided. However, the worst of the disease's impact might be found well out of the public eye in isolated areas where awareness and communications aren't nearly as good. It's likely that the majority of the deaths would never make the news. The disease would have the chance to continue circulating there, growing and potentially mutating, until it once again evades the new antibiotics and vaccines, and the whole cycle begins again. And then, of course, people will once again say it's all a government conspiracy. But if you think a modern-day plague sounds terrifying, just wait until you see how people coped back then. Watch Why the Dark Ages Were the Worst Time to Be Alive, or click this video instead.